Gardening from the Ground Up with Corey, Brad, and Cody.
Hi, I'm Baxter County Agent Brad Runzik with the University of Arkansas System Division of Agriculture Cooperative Extension Service. Welcome to the Gardening from the Ground Up video series. This series of short 3 to 5 minute videos will walk you through how to create a basic traditional tilled garden spot in your landscape. I'll be joined by Fulton County Agent Corey Tyler and Sharp County Agent Cody Stroud. We'll take you from breaking ground the first time to planting to basic care and maintenance and all the way up to the harvest of your first ripe red tomato. The recommendations we make along the way are research-based, reliable management decisions that will ensure both the success of your new garden as well as the safety of the food you produce. The topics discussed throughout this series will be somewhat general since not all situations and growing seasons are alike. For specific recommendations, you should reach out to your local county extension office. And with that, let's get to it. Perhaps the first topic to address is where to locate the garden. Sun exposure is a major consideration for any vegetable garden. Vegetables do best with full sun, and that means a minimum of 6 hours of direct sunlight per day. Now, many cool season vegetables like cabbage and broccoli can handle less than that. Keep in mind that the sun and shade locations will be different during winter than they are in summer. Proper drainage is also a critical component. Sites where water tends to pool or not drain quickly will result in plant disease issues further down the road. An area with a bit of a slope is even preferred. Also, there must be ample topsoil present for plants to grow. Thin, rocky areas, which are very much present in much of Arkansas, will not support a successful vegetable garden. In those instances, one should look to raised beds or container gardening. Lastly is water. There will be times a year where the garden will need to be watered due to lack of rainfall. Ease of access to that water must be accounted for, whether it's from a garden hose coming from your home, a nearby creek, or even rain barrels. Know how you intend to provide water before selecting your garden site.
My name's Corey Tyler. I'm the Agriculture Extension Agent in Fulton County. Today we're going to talk a little bit about garden sizing. One of the first things we need to do is decide on how big our garden needs to be. And there's a few considerations we need to have with that. And one of those is, how many people are we going to be feeding? Are we going to be feeding just a couple people, or are we going to be utilizing it for a whole family? Also, are we going to be utilizing it for a fresh vegetable garden, meaning we're going to pick it and utilize it as it grows, or are we going to be preserving a majority of this? Plant size too will also determine how big your garden size needs to be. For example, if we were to plant watermelons, we would need more space than if we were just to plant peppers. Plant size really plays a factor in determining the garden size itself.
Now, once we've determined where our garden will be located and what size it needs to be, it's time to get prepared. The first step in preparing a site is to get rid of the existing vegetation. Lawn grasses and weeds are competition for your future vegetables. They steal water and nutrients. This is most easily accomplished by using a rotary tiller to break the ground and kill some of the grass and sod that is there. One of the benefits of tilling it is that you expose many of the underground rhizomes and roots of plants, such as Bermuda grass, which will make them more apt to be winter killed to reduce this vegetation. It's better to do this both in the late fall and late winter prior to planting, but if late winter is your only option, that'll work. It's not a bad idea to till the area in both directions to better break up the ground and kill out that old vegetation. Once complete and the grass and weeds have had time to die, rake it off, trying not to take too much soil with it. Now that we've gotten our site prepped, it's time for soil sampling. Soil sampling helps to identify any nutrient deficiencies we may have and correct soil pH. To take a soil sample, all you need is a bucket and a small shovel. We're using a soil sampling probe, but any small shovel will work. Go around the area and take 20 to 25 small samples at a depth of 4 to 6 inches. It doesn't need to be exact, but avoid getting only surface soil or soil that's below 6 inches. Take whatever amount you get and mix it up, removing any large rocks or roots. It doesn't have to be finely sifted, you just need to get out the big stuff. You can get soil sample boxes from your county office. Take out enough soil to fill that box and turn it in to your local extension office. Typically, it'll take 2 to 3 weeks to get the soil analysis report back. Then you can visit with your county extension agent to identify what fertilizer and/or lime might be needed. If you don't have a soil test, an application of 8 pounds of triple 13 fertilizer per 1,000 square feet will work in a pinch. But guessing isn't the way to go. Take a sample. We'll cover how to read the soil report, fertilizing materials, and applying fertilizer in the next video. For more detailed information about taking soil samples and to learn about the U of A System Soil Sampling Lab, check out these links, which can also be found below.